This is Bishop Gregory Brewer's sermon at Holy Trinity Episcopal Church, Melbourne, Florida, October 27th, 2013.
I know it might be difficult to imagine, especially if you've been coming to church for quite some time. But if you are a non-churched, and especially if you're a non-churched young adult, this parable will come to you as a shock. And the reason is because what Jesus is holding up in this story and indicting in this story is an attitude that in our present culture is considered just normal, the way we do things, especially when it comes to this character who is described as a Pharisee. Listen to the opening line. Jesus told this parable to the son who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. If that doesn't describe the current state of our political discourse, I don't know what that is. I mean, if you listen to people on the left, they've got it right, and the real problem with this country are those retrogrades who can't get with the program, who think it's back in the 1950s. If you go to the people on the right, what they will tell you is, if people would finally listen to us instead of lying about what's really going on in this country, then they would understand that what they're doing is taking this country in an entirely wrong direction. Right? So take your pick. MSNBC, Fox News, doesn't matter. It's always a point of view. We're right. They're the ones that are putting this country in deep trouble. And unfortunately, the church is actually no different at one level. So instead of it being conservative and liberal politics, it becomes conservative and liberal theology. And it's the very same thing. So what you hear from on the left are, God is continuing to speak to us. We are not hidebound by the traditions of the past. It's time for us to move forward. We are, in fact, here's the key word, in a very progressive age. And it's time for us to move forward. On the other hand, you hear the people on the right say, progressivism, that's abandonment of the true faith. We're the only ones who are sticking with the teachings of the scripture. And therefore, it's our job to uphold those because they do not change and they're just dead wrong. Have you heard that? Nod your head. Of course you have. Me too. This is what normal life is like in many parts of our church, but certainly within the media and our culture. A heightened sense of batten down the hatches, we're the revolutionaries, we're the ones who are going to take, you fill in the blank, this country, this church, in the right direction. And everybody else is not to be trusted. It can be true even in terms of culture as well. Quite apart from these discourses about politics and religion, you hear the same thing, particularly when it comes to issues of music. Whether you're talking about the traditional classical pieces, or the progressive classicals on one side, or the more contemporary pop stuff, and the disdain that is held with even by hipsters, much less the whole rap music genre, it's a kind of new tribalism, where we're the ones who are on the vanguard, or we're the ones who are upholding what real music should be, depending on where you are in the spectrum. And the rest of it's just trash, or it's Pablo, or there's even this kind of snooty sort of, oh yeah, well, I guess if you like that sort of thing. Right? It all fits the description. Those who trust in themselves that they were righteous, politically well-informed, biblically faithful, culturally on the cutting edge. New words for righteousness. And what? They regard others with contempt. Now, as I told the crew last night when I was here, as I look at the story that Jesus is trying to describe, I actually feel like in my heart, the real me is somewhere in the middle. That there are, in fact, parts of me that deeply resonate with the Pharisee. Doesn't mean I'm necessarily proud of it, but it's true. Because I have clear opinions, And the whole idea of somehow trying to find a way to work things out in the midst of differing opinions is literally, for many of us, and especially in our culture, a lost art. If there's anything that you see in what's happening politically, that is that. There is almost the lost capacity to pull people in a room and say, okay, for the good of the country, we've got to find a way to work this out. Same in the church. I mean, if you really do believe that you're righteous and everybody else is to be held in contempt, you're not going to compromise on anything because everything becomes a matter of faith and therefore cardinal doctrine that should not in any way be evaded. But I want to say to you, I'm not sure Jesus sees it this way. But I still love the ability to stand on a corner and feel really righteous about being right. Come on, you do too. It's a part of what it means to be human. But you see, Jesus characterizes in this very kind of broad stroke, cartoonish parable to make a point. I'm not being critical. I'm saying it's broad strokes because he's trying to make a point that there is within each of us something of the Pharisee. And because there is something within us that is very much like the Pharisee, we don't know what to do with Jesus holding up the publican who beats his breast and says, mercy, it's all I ask for from God. Because this attitude really does get carried into our life with God, where in particular, because I've heard preachers say this, and it's very true to parts of the Old Testament, that if I'm obedient to the Lord, then therefore there's a kind of quid pro quo. If I do these things, then God will bless me, right? So I'm doing these things, and therefore, God, I need you to bless me because that's your part of the bargain. That's really, you see, what the Pharisee is saying. He is not being inaccurate when he talks about fasting twice a week and giving money to the poor. That's a part of what it means to be a Pharisee. Pharisees were, in fact, in contrast to some of the criticism of the New Testament, were considered, at least by Judaism, as very commendable characters, because in the midst of political repression on the part of those pagan Romans, they were the ones who were upholding the law. So, particularly for Jesus' listeners, when he tells this story, they're shocked that the Pharisees are the bad guys. That's not what they would have expected at all. Nor would they have expected the publican to be considered the hero of the story. Because what's a publican? A publican is someone who cannot keep the law. Sometimes that's because he's not Jewish. Sometimes that's because he's mixed-race Samaritan, which means they're just not to be trusted. Or sometimes it's because he's doing something that's notorious. Lots of people were considered publicans in that sense. And yet he's the one who's justified before God. Here's the point. The point is this. While I relate to the Pharisee in a very, very real way, and there are parts of me that resonate deeply with that kind of confidence, because that's what he has confidence. The dark side of his example is confidence can quickly, and it has in this story, shifted into a kind of pride which says, I'm right and everybody else is wrong. And because I'm right, God, that means you bless me. Uh-huh. Neither of which, the I'm right and you're wrong, or the God, you bless me because I'm obedient, have any place of blessing within the New Testament. Because you see, here's what's going on with the publican. And this is the lesson. You see, for the publican, he knows that he has absolutely no justified rationale for asking for God's blessing at all. None. So all he can do, you see, is cry out to God for what? For mercy. What is mercy? Mercy is undeserved favor. Mercy is, I don't qualify for anything except your judgment, O God, but I'm here crying out for mercy. He can do that for one reason and for one reason only. In the midst of his immoral, bad, not keeping the law behavior, he's got something right about God, and that's the fact that God is love. That he is good. And that's what he's counting on. Oh God, if this really is a quid pro quo universe where all of us are judged strictly by our behavior, I know I'm just flat out sunk. I mean, that's really what he's saying. And therefore, but here's my problem, God. Even though I don't qualify for any mercy whatsoever, if there's one thing I need in this universe, it is your mercy. Oh, Lord, is there any way you can look past the wickedness of my behavior, the thoughts that I don't like about myself, those places of shame that I don't want to tell anybody about, much less confess to you? Is there any way that you can look past all of that and find some place in me that you are willing to bless, not because I deserve it, but because, God, I need it? That's mercy. That's mercy. And Jesus, see, who is God incarnate. So that's what gives this story punch. We're not getting just somehow a rabbi's opinion. We're getting God's opinion here. God always pours out his mercy and his love on people who count more on his character than they do on the goodness of their behavior. Do you hear that? God does bless those who count on his character more than they do his behavior as they stand in his presence. Because that's an act of faith. There'd be plenty in the world that might convince you, if you didn't know better, if you didn't see it in Jesus, that God really is not particularly good, that he's capricious and that bad things happen. And we wrestle, all of us, do we not, with this sense of we want the world to be more justified. But you know where that puts us? That puts us right here. Because Paul is not kidding when he says in Romans, there is none righteous, no, not one. That's not a truth we want to live with very long. Because exactly what it does is that it pokes holes in the veneers of our good behavior and exposes in a very way that I do not like my need to want what I want when I want it, even from God. Hello? Yeah? Let's talk reality here. When in fact, when I get into that place, which I can easily get into, I need to be reminded that who does God bless? That? No. This. Where I can say, God, I thank you that within your mercy, there is no scale where you put the good deeds on one side and the bad deeds on the other. And the ones with all the good side are the ones who you listen to. No, Jesus has thrown the scale off the table. Instead, your heart is turned to those who can open their hearts to him and who can be bare honest about what's really happening inside of them as far as is possible, because we do lie to ourselves, do we not? And God knows that. He knows that our view of ourselves, including this Pharisee, is really very skewed. It doesn't have a lot of reality to it at all. Because all of us play this game where we use our good behaviors as a way to shield ourselves from the impact and perhaps the guilt and the fear that the bad behavior actually creates. So when we say, it's sort of like we work ourselves up into it. We sort of think about the things that are good. You know, think positive thoughts here. That's what I'm supposed to be doing right now. And so I emphasize the positives. I hope the negatives go away. And that allows me to sort of put on the mask and put my foot forward and say, when somebody says, how are you? I can go, I'm fine, thank you. Because I've held this stuff way back here someplace, hoping no one will see. Hoping I don't remember. And God is the one who says, nope, that's just a part of your heart too, just like the good stuff is. And I want all of you to come into my presence. Because you know what? Even though you don't, I love all of you. Not just the good parts. And I know everything about there is about you, including the things you don't want to admit, including the things you don't even know about. And I want to bring you the very mercy and healing and forgiveness for which your heart longs. Even as you are working so hard to try to be right. So this story is an invitation to reality. Not only about who we are, but about who God is. He is the one whose mercy endures forever. That we can have the freedom to come in and say everything. I mean, that's what the Psalms teach us. Everything about what's going on inside of us. And God doesn't blink. He's actually glad that we're willing to be honest. So that he can pour out upon us the very things that our heart needs so desperately. That's the good news of this story, is that the publican came home justified, right with God, knowing the very mercy and peace of God in his life. And isn't that what we long for more than anything else? It leaves trying to be right in the dust every time. It's the experience of the peace of God, the sense of his mercy. It's the beginning to laugh a little bit about our own pretensions at goodness and the kind of silliness and even danger of that kind of stiff-necked pride where I hold on to my opinion and I look down at those who don't keep the same opinions I do, for whatever reason. But I begin to see people in many ways very similar to me. We're all trying to put the best foot forward. We're trying to look good. We're in this game together. And even though it's not very nice, that's kind of how the game gets played often or not. And I have all of a sudden been invited to look at people not on the basis of their pretensions, because see, I have mine too, right? But instead to look at them as human beings that God deeply and profoundly loves and cares for, just like me, and neither of us deserve it, underline. And he gives it to both of us freely. And it is that mutual understanding of the very humanity that makes us who we are, that allows us to be able to have conversations across the bridge of disagreement, that allows us to begin to find a way to work and serve together, even in those places where things are not particularly happy. Because the problem isn't just out there, it's in here, every single time. So, today, this is an invitation to allow all of your heart to speak. And know that God hears every single voice inside. And that what we receive, not on the basis of what we deserve, but of what he chooses to give us, is his wondrous, justified mercy. Amen.